Good morning, everyone. Have for a number of years now, we have had the same format, which is to say that it's not a debate. It's more an opportunity for the membership, and all of these questions that we will ask this morning, they have all come from our membership, our chamber membership, the Government Affairs Committee, vets, and might clean up some of the wordsmithing needs of a question, but the questions this morning will be coming directly from our membership. So with that, we're going to have 2 or 3 minutes, depending on the question, and we'll announce there's kind of 3 sections here. There's an opening remarks that come in the form of a question and an answer, and then there's kind of the middle ground where there's going to be about 9 questions, and then there's a closing question at the end. So all of them are either 2 or 3 minutes in length. And if anybody has ever been here, and there's a lot of familiar faces in the audience, if anybody's ever been here, you've seen Donna Long here from the chamber stick up the yellow or red card. So the candidates do know when their time is almost up, 30 seconds from being up, and then when it actually is. In the event we have anybody long-winded, I'm usually not going to play police officer. However, Donna's going to turn their mic off. And when that happens, it becomes a lot more difficult for y'all to hear them. So usually we're able to get the message across. So that said, we do try to stick to the time to be fair to both candidates this morning and to all candidates as we do these forums. But again, it's about having an opportunity to ask questions, hear their answers. Anybody who might have a question that isn't asked this morning, I would encourage you. I think both of the candidates will be around after the forum this morning. We'd be happy to field some more personal questions. So with that, I'll have the candidates come up. And so we have the current mayor, Mayor David Geisberts, and former mayor, Bob Brucci. If you all come up. Technical difficulties here. All right. So when there are more candidates, and you'll see this when we get into the Board of Ed and to the City Council debates here, we actually will randomly pick names this morning. Both candidates will answer all questions. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go back and forth as to who gets to go first. But it becomes a lot simpler. The math becomes a lot simpler when you have two candidates sitting up here before you. So this morning we're going to hear from both of them on every question. So with that, we'll get started with the first question. So it is more or less an opening statement. There will be 3 minutes on the clock for each candidate to answer this question. But the question is, please tell us what you believe to be the 3 most critical priorities and initiatives for revitalizing the city of Hagerstown. We'll start with the person closest to me, Bob Brucci.
Good morning, and thank you to the Chamber for hosting this event, and thank all of you for getting up so early in the morning and attending. There are plenty of challenges that we face in the city of Hagerstown. We have an ever-increasing deficit that we're looking at in the next fiscal year that needs to be addressed. There are home ownership issues that we have that we also need to address. And although that through our home ownership program in the city of Hagerstown, we've done some good things, but went to the wayside lately. We also need to focus on one of not only Washington County and Hagerstown's greatest problems, but also across this country, and that's our heroin epidemic that we have. I believe that Sheriff Mullendore's Day Reporting Center will be a huge help and a step in the right direction. And I also believe that we need to come together as a community, that we can address this issue, where we can we can treat the addicted, and we can also prosecute those dealers who are poisoning our people. So in order for us to move forward in our community, we need to focus on how do we bring jobs into our community, because one of the things that we have lacked in the last couple years is a very strong economic development department. City government's responsibility, or any government, is not to actually create jobs. The government's responsibility is to create that infrastructure that gives the opportunity to create jobs. And we can see that. We can see it right now on Manhattan Farms. where the county is moving forward to put in the infrastructure that will, in an area that will eventually be annexed into the city of Hagerstown. So, you know, the county at least is doing things right. We, on the other hand, are slow in moving economic development forward. I look forward to representing those silent majority individuals out there who have talked to me over the last few years, who complain about things such as the increase in taxes and the lack of cooperation, unanswered phone calls, things like that. These are people who talk to me on a constant basis, and I believe that I'm committed to bringing fiscal responsibility and a common sense government back to the city of Hagerstown. Thank you. What is this clock on the computer, John?
I was confused by that too, Bob.
I mean, and it says I have 2 minutes, 57 seconds, and four. Yeah, I mean, what's going on?
Minor technical detail. We're fixing it right now.
Good. Yeah, well, then he needs to turn that off.
David.
Well, thank you again to the Chamber for hosting this forum. I think any opportunity we have to have these kind of public conversations is a really good opportunity. And it's an honor and a privilege to serve as the mayor of Hagerstown. The three most critical priorities or initiatives, I believe, number one, we have to continue to bring investment to Hagerstown. I think the public sector has a proper role in helping make investments that spur the private sector to make those investments. And I think what we've done in partnering with the Board of Education, county government, the University System of Maryland, public dollars that are invested are bringing in more private dollars. And I think investment certainly should continue to be one of our main priorities. I'm very proud that we had a first third grant program that was very popular and well utilized. And really the point behind that was that we can take reserve fund money, which is should only be used for one-time capital expenditures, and we partnered with folks in the private sector to bring investment into the city. And mainly because we know that any of these old buildings in downtown Hagerstown require so much investment to bring them up to code. And by the way, most of those codes are state codes, but to bring them up to code, and it's just not feasible for many investors to close that gap to get a return on their investment. So when we invest those public dollars in private property, we are actually helping to shore up our assessable base. And I think that is one of the most critical ways that we can address the budgetary issues that we face is to continue to do whatever we can to shore up our assessable base. Number two, I believe housing is another critical priority, and we've done a lot in the last few years to really focus on supporting our neighborhoods. How can we keep our house prices from further decline? How can we improve blight and get rid of blight in neighborhoods? And what I've learned is that, you know, there are many things that government cannot do. But one of the things that the mayor of Hagerstown in particular gets to do is appoint members of the Housing Authority without council input. So I think housing is crucial. We had a housing summit. We have a lot more work to do. The third initiative or priority, I believe, is our image, that we need to change the story of Hagerstown. We need to talk about all the great things that we've been able to do, the high-speed broadband, the Antietam cable invested in Hagerstown is huge. All of these things I think we can use to help improve our image.
Thank you both. That was the opening statement section. We'll now go to the next nine questions, which will have 2 minutes each for your answer. First question, what aspects of Hagerstown are attractive to you, and what's already working, and how will you build on those things that are working? So at this time, we'll start with David Geisberts.
Well, I love Hagerstown because we have so much great history here in Hagerstown. I love our architecture. I love our geography. I've been to so many places around this country and around the world, and not to sound like Dorothy, but there really is no place like home. So, you know, part of what I think is working is that, you know, one of the things I noticed first coming into office is that we tend to live in our own silos, and getting the community engaged and coming up with a shared vision for what we all want to see in Hagerstown, something that all stakeholders have buy-in with, I think has been something that's working. The city's efforts to engage not only the business community, but residents, artists, other communities in Hagerstown is really important, and so I think we should continue to build on that. I think, you know, we're often compared to Frederick, and I think we're better than Frederick. Maybe I'm a little biased. No offense, Paul, and all you other Frederick folks, but I know, but you, so the, you know, one of my philosophies is that we have to turn liabilities into assets, and I think if Frederick can provide an example of anything, it is that cities can do those things, whether it's flooding, whether it's old buildings that need a lot of investment. We can take those liabilities and turn them into assets. So I think some of those are the things that are working, and we can build on those assets as we move forward.
Thank you. Bob?
Okay. Well, I, of course, believe that the city of Hagerstown is definitely the choice for people who want good quality of living at a reasonable price. You know, we have some great amenities here in our city. The University of Maryland in downtown, the expansion over in the CVS building, which I promoted and championed. You know, there are fantastic things that we can do in this town. Fairgrounds Park, you know, we've watched that develop over the last 15 years. You know, we have a great golf course in Hagerstown, a little 9-hole golf course, but guess what? It's a fantastic place to play a quick 9 holes. We have great people. We have great employees. One of our biggest assets, actually, is the fact that we have great city employees who are here and who have helped maintain the city of Hagerstown. What we have to do as a city now is we have to retain those employees. We can't continue to not honor contracts, not pay our employees, and watch as our employees leave for greener pastures. So it's important that we take care of our employees so that they continue to do the great job they do for us. You know, I've seen both the common sense and fiscally responsible side of city government. Back when we hired 10 additional firefighters, 5 additional police officers, created a new fire station, maintained our streets, and balanced a budget, all without a tax increase. And we've ended up having a 15.7 percent tax increase in the last 3 years. Regular citizens can't maintain that kind of a tax increase. We have to control our spending so that we can utilize our money and spend wisely.
Good. Thank you. Second question in this section. Can you provide an example of a conversation or conversations that you've had with a business owner? If so, how have those conversations influenced your decision to run for office? Back over to Bob Ritchie to start.
Well, I'll tell you what. I have a lot of conversations with business owners, and none of them are any good anymore. They're concerned. They're concerned about the fact that this administration has raised property taxes 15.7%. And business personal property tax 15.7% on small business. They're concerned that they won't be able to afford to do business in the city of Hagerstown anymore. They're concerned with the way that they get treated when they want to increase the size of their business or change something, the way they get treated by permits and inspections. They're concerned about the way that they get no response from city government. They make phone calls, and their phone calls don't get returned. Those are the kind of things that, when I talk to local businesses, that they tell me. Now, you're going to have people who tell you, oh, those are stories from 20 years ago. But I'm here to tell you that a story from just last Saturday, when I ran across a person who owns, and I'm sure you know which building it is, the old post office on Northern Avenue. Catania is what it's called now. This individual, I remember when he bought that building, when he rehabbed that building, and everybody was excited because we were taking an old building that was now vacant and turning it into something good. Well, he got visited by their vacant building inspectors who cited him for peeling paint on the back of his building. Why aren't we focused on bringing in a business to fill that building as opposed to making that person feel like the city doesn't want them around anymore?
Mayor Gosford.
Sure. Well, I too have conversations with business owners frequently, and just yesterday met with the relatively new owner of 920 West Washington Street, the old West Washington Street School. And what I think, I don't know if these conversations really compel me to run for office, but they certainly give me a good insight into what's happening in the business community. But what I think business people want most of all is certainty. It's not the fact that they have to have compliance with codes or regulations. Business people, developers do that anywhere they go. What they want is certainty. And what I think we've been able to do over these last several years is give people an idea of where we're heading. We have a plan. It's in writing, in full color, when it comes to what we're doing with the city center revitalization. I do want to address what we just heard about the taxes. I want people to know, for the property tax rate, we are paying the same effective tax rate in the 2016-17 fiscal year than we did in the 2009-2010 fiscal year. It's in our budget book, section 3, page 6, everyone can see it. So effectively, people's taxes since 2009-2010 have been relatively stable. I think, the key is, how do we keep our assessable base from continuing to decline? And I think through, I'm not gonna apologize for having standards. I think what I know is that business people want certainty. So as long as everybody is being treated fairly, I think that is what we're going to have to continue to pursue. So, I hear people complain about regulations and taxes, but I think certainty is what most business people are looking for.
Thank you. At this point, I'm going to ask Aaron to come up, and he's going to take the next section of questions.
Still earning my wings, you know? All right. Question 4, this will be for Mr. Geiswertz. During recent focus group sessions, a number of downtown business owners expressed frustration with the perceived us versus them working environment as it relates to working within the city. Beyond the political environment, do you see a need for a cultural shift within city bureaucracy? If so, how would you address this issue and improve the business climate in the city of Hagerstown?
Well, I do appreciate the work that the focus group undertook. I'm very proud that we were able to bring Main Street to the city of Hagerstown, which is just another way that we can engage not only the business community, but residents and stakeholders who really care about the health and well-being of our city and the economy. There is, unfortunately, frequently an us versus them mentality, and I think that's not just as it relates to business and city government. And unfortunately, that adversarialism is sort of runs through our society as a whole. But I think that's a two-way street, and I don't believe that the city creates a hostile environment to do business in the city of Hagerstown. Can we always improve customer service? Absolutely. If there is an incident where a customer doesn't feel like they've been treated fairly or adequately, I think it's important for the mayor to know about that, and that we work with the city administrator and directors of departments to address those issues as they come up. But I think creating a sense of mutuality, which is the paradigm under which I like to operate, is really crucial because it isn't about us versus them. I do believe we have a shared vision for what we want to see in the city of Hagerstown. And again, I think as long as we're consistent and fair and treat everybody with respect, I think we will be well on our way to continuing on the path of economic development.
Remember when I talked about the silent majority? The stakeholders that Mr. Geisberts talks about are part of that silent majority. They feel like they get brought into a committee, into a meeting, into a room, and they talk about things, and then they feel like their voices aren't heard after that. That's the problem. When business people talk to me, they talk to me about issues such as loitering and crime and quality of life in the city of Hagerstown, and that a great business that just opened up about a year ago out on Garland Grove Boulevard. The city of Hagerstown, the permits and planning people, unfortunately, they put stone as opposed to grass in the front of their building, and it looks great, it looks fantastic, but the city of Hagerstown, even though, granted, it got approved through that way through the planning commission to have grass, but stone is easier to maintain. It looks nicer. You don't have to worry about it. There's no overgrown weeds like you see around the city of Hagerstown on a bunch of city streets and stuff like that. And they gave them a hard time. Now, luckily, they gave them temporary UNO when they wanted to open, because without that temporary UNO, they wouldn't be open until they went and got a variance to the plan. It's common sense governing, people. That's what it is. And unfortunately, we don't have that. It all can't be about a stick. Sometimes it's got to be a carrot.
All right. Again to Mr. Brucci. Name one initiative you would champion to increase home ownership and reduce the need for subsidized housing in Hagerstown. And as a subset to that, what were your takeaways from the recent housing summit?
I believe that the housing summit was actually a fantastic idea, and I applaud Dave and Kristen Elshire, who actually championed that for 2 years until it happened, to make it happen. We're very unique in our community, all right? We have blue-collar workers, we have white-collar workers, we have those who are on assistance, who need that assistance. Granted, we have probably more than our fair share of Section 8 housing, but I know good people who are on Section 8 and who utilize that for their families to help raise their families in a household where they can actually have a household, which is what we want in this country, if I'm not mistaken. We want families to raise families. The city of Hagerstown purchased at 64 East Franklin Street a residence for $30,000. Applaud, way to go, great deal. All right, it was in bankruptcy, it was being held by a bank. Unfortunately, they're spending $268,000 to rehab it. Now, this is a single family residence in the first block of East Franklin Street that they're going to have nearly $300,000 in, with no backyard, no off-street parking. I just got to scratch my head and think, couldn't there have been a better use of that money? And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about common sense. Again, these are everyday issues that we face, and everyday issues that have to be addressed. And if we don't approach it with a common sense form of government, then we're never going to get ahead.
Well, that's a lot to unpack in 3 minutes, but I'm going to do my best. So first, let me respond to this notion of 64 East Franklin Street as being this big money pit. Yes, we got a foreclosed property, and unfortunately, the city is in this position of being the developer of last resort. I just mentioned earlier this gap that many people are unable to achieve or see in their return on the investment. So the money that's being invested into the property, however, is community development block grant money. It is not city general fund dollars. So I just want to make sure that that's clear. But to increase homeownership, I believe, you know, one of the takeaways I came from the housing summit was that, you know, when we look at the future and we look at our imbalance of rentals versus homeownership, I wonder if this is a liability that we cannot turn into an asset. As millennials come into the market, what we know is that they are frequently delaying marriage, they are staying single longer, they are looking to rent, not own. So I think there may be a potential to turn that liability into an asset. But I do believe that home ownership is important. I think we should continue to achieve a higher percentage of home ownership. I'm more concerned about folks who own their homes outright, who are cash poor, working poor people, who are unable to make major investments in the property that they already own. So I would like to continue to explore ways to focus on redeveloping neighborhoods with current homeownership, to strengthen the neighborhoods where we have homeownership, which has been one of the strategies outlined in our city center community plan. As far as subsidized housing, I don't think there's any administration who's done more to address this issue, to really get at the heart of how did we get here and what can we do moving forward. And the Housing Summit, I believe, was just the start of that work.
All right, number six. Drug abuse, homelessness, crime, and other societal challenges are impacting the economic viability of downtown Hagerstown. Is there a particular initiative you would champion that has the potential to improve the socioeconomic conditions in Hagerstown today? Mr. Geisberts.
You know, these are very complex social problems when we talk about drug use, homelessness, crime. Many of them are all intertwined. People commit crimes in order to get their fix, and because of, you know, their drug use, they don't have a job, they end up homeless. I mean, there is a vicious cycle for many, many people. And I do recognize the fact that these are issues, wherever crime happens, it's an issue for anyone who experiences that crime, no matter what level of crime it is. And it does have an impact on economic development. I do, you know, what I know is that the three-legged stool is housing, education, and jobs. I really believe that anything that we do that can help promote those three, what I call the three-legged stool, I think that's how you prevent violence in a community. I think that's what people gives people hope to keep them from turning to drugs to escape their reality. I think, you know, those are what I have tried to focus on in terms of the priorities, what we can look at achieving for the city of Hagerstown. So I know there are no easy answers. You know, we have many service agencies in the city of Hagerstown that are nonprofit or otherwise affiliated who are working very hard to address those problems. And I think one of the things we can continue to do is to help coordinate those agencies, get them out of their silos, and have more collaborative conversations about how we address those particular issues, especially as it relates to economic development.
I'm going to go back to the last question for just a second. You know, David mentions that he's more concerned about those individuals who own their home outright, who can't afford the maintenance and things like that. And I agree, that's a problem, okay? And that's definitely a concern in our city. But when you increase taxes on them by 15.7%, you don't make it any easier for them to afford to maintain their house. You know, people in the city of Hagerstown who are currently homeowners are looking to move outside the city of Hagerstown. Case in point, a couple over on Oak Hill who got a citation letter from code compliance from the city of Hagerstown who said that you need to remove that couch in your backyard. I was talking with them the other day when I was knocking on doors, and they said, you know, we called, which I think was great because someone actually answered the phone, and they said, oh, and she said, listen, we've never had a couch in our backyard. What are you talking about? And he said, oh, he said, never mind. He said, we got the complaint, we sent the notice, never even went and looked. That's a problem. It's a problem for homeowners to go through that. Listen, we have a problem in our core, not just our core, but everywhere in the city of Hagerstown when it comes to crime and drugs and all those kind of things. I will work closely with our new chief, and we will devise ways to counteract these problems and make our citizens feel safe and secure, and the businesses in downtown feel safe. Thanks.
Number seven. The mayor has a unique opportunity to be an ambassador to those outside of the city. Is there a potential stakeholder you would approach about investing within the city? Mr. Brucci.
A potential stakeholder. Well, you know, one of the things, if you can recall, long, long ago, and I know people don't like to hear that, but back in 2009, we had an initiative called Hagerstown Advance. In Hagerstown Advance, the goal of that initiative was to go out and do exactly that, to go out to potential investors in the city of Hagerstown and talk to them about the benefits of being in Hagerstown. You know, not to sit back and wait for a phone to ring in the community and economic development department. It was to actually be proactive, go out and recruit business. And that's important that we do that. You know, we've seen the loss of some great businesses in Hagerstown. If you remember back in the olden days, in the heyday of the city of Hagerstown, you know, we had things like Roper Eastern and Victor Products and those kind of manufacturing jobs. We don't have that anymore, okay? Will we ever get manufacturing jobs back? I really can't say yes or no about that. I think it would be great if we could, but even today, as you know, that Volvo Mack truck are laying off more people. So, you know, we have to focus on those 21st century companies, those high-tech biotech companies, which is why we should be aggressively searching for those companies who want to expand or move their business to the East Coast, where they have a great highway system, easy access to Dulles and BWI for their people, things like that, great amenities. But we have to be the ones to go look for that. They aren't going to come knocking on our door. We have to go knock on theirs.
I do see the mayor's role as being a good ambassador for the city of Hagerstown. I really believe strongly that some of the initiatives we've promoted in these last 4 years will help us attract companies that are looking for exactly what Bob just mentioned, a high quality of life, low cost of living and doing business, great amenities. And one company in particular that I, you know, if you're asking for a specific stakeholder or investor, I believe is PayPal. When they announced that they were not going to move their new office in North Carolina due to discriminatory laws against certain groups of people and that they were looking for another place, I immediately sent an email out to various folks in the community, not just in the city of Hagerstown, and said, why don't we have a concerted effort to try to recruit this company to come to Hagerstown? Thanks to Antietam Cable, we now have the first privately funded gigabit city in the state of Maryland. I believe that is a huge feather in our economic development cap, to be able to recruit a company like PayPal who will be looking for that kind of service in order to do business and to attract the workers who will be hopefully living in the city of Hagerstown and enjoying those great amenities. So that would be one potential investor or stakeholder that I think we can go after.
Do you think that professional baseball is an economic driver for Hagerstown? Why or why not? Mr. Geisberts.
Yes, I do. Why? I think it's been pretty clearly demonstrated that there is a multi-million dollar direct impact on our local economy with the spending from the Hagerstown Suns, the players, the visiting teams, folks who come to Hagerstown solely to get a hotel room and catch a game. I do believe that we should be working with the ownership of the Hagerstown Suns to come up with a plan for a facility that is worthy of all of us as a community, that's more than just about baseball. I have said that over and over again, that I believe it should be like we've done with other initiatives, it should be a community-wide effort to ensure that all the stakeholders have a seat at the table. But I do believe that it is a positive impact on our community, and I will continue to support the team. One of the interesting things to note about the Hagerstown Suns in their more recent history since the early 80s is that some of the highest attendance at the Hagerstown Suns, I think the highest attendance year, was 1991, which was in the middle of a recession. So this idea that you can have a fun, affordable family activity in the form of professional baseball works for Hagerstown. I think we are a great market. I think the Nationals, I believe, recognize that. I think a lot of other folks recognize that. And it's a great way to promote our city. When these players for the Suns go to other towns and other states and other cities, they're representing Hagerstown. They have Hagerstown on their jerseys, and it really puts us on the map. So I do believe that it is an economic driver.
Yes. It is true. The Hagerstown Suns pump about $3 million into the economy locally every single season. You know, I was blessed, actually, to be able to spend time as an employee at the Hagerstown Suns in the front office. I've left that position as of September 30th. And I will tell you that having the intimate knowledge of how baseball works now, as opposed to what people believe baseball is and how it works, there's a big difference. One of the first things that we have to do in order to keep this great amenity is to actually have a conversation with the ownership about whether or not they want to stay. Some people will say, well, we've been in constant contact with Mr. Quinn, and that's just not true. It just isn't true. There hasn't been a conversation. Let's have that conversation. Now, maybe that conversation won't go the way that the city of Hagerstown wants it to go, but let's have it anyway, because we don't know. Currently, right now, we have the Hagerstown Suns have a two-year lease that runs through the 17 and 18 seasons. After that, who knows what's going to happen? But if we don't have a conversation with the ownership about it, we're never going to know. And it's true. The Nationals love our geographic area here because it's quick to Harrisburg or to Potomac or even to Nats Park. So, you know, we've done some great things here. The Hagerstown Suns have. And, you know, we've got players now at the national level. You know, Defoe, Severino, those kind of people who are big stars now, who will be big stars in the Washington Nationals organization. So I believe that retaining minor league baseball in Hagerstown is very important. It's one of those amenities that you can sell to those businesses that you are trying to attract.
Mr. Bucci, in the past, the city has purchased properties, secured grants, and provided direct incentives to the private sector. Do you believe this should be the city's role in downtown development, or should the city only provide necessary services and leave all development up to the private sector without any incentives?
I believe there has to be a mix. I truly do. You know, David talks about the First Third Grant Program. Thankfully, my administration left them with a $1.5 million surplus that they could use in order to fund that program. I think it's very important that we offer incentives. During my administrations, we created the PEP program. We created the Upper Floor Redevelopment Loan Fund. We did those kind of things because we know how hard it is to try to rehab an old building. You know, one of the things that people like about Frederick is that they took old buildings that were there and they did great things. Well, they did all those great things before regulations like the American Disabilities Act and things like that came into place. You know, Frederick, unfortunately, suffered a great disaster in the flood of 1972. You know, and the state of Maryland gave him $20 million. Well, today's dollars, that's like, you know, $134 million. So if the state of Maryland would give the city of Hagerstown $134 million, guess what? I believe the city of Hagerstown could do great things, too. But we definitely don't want a natural disaster or a war or something like that. So, you know, it's important that the city of Hagerstown continues to fund those grant programs that help promote business and help grow business.
I just want to go back to the last question before I address this one. I think it's quite fresh that you, Bob, would consider it a blessing to work for the Hagerstown Sons. I think other people might call it something else. But I do think that it is appropriate for the public to make investments not only in infrastructure that help promote growth and opportunity for business, but to also provide grants and incentives. I do believe that, once again, many times the city is often in the position of being the developer of last resort, as I mentioned before. What does that mean? That means that, you know, even though a property may be in foreclosure and you can get it for pennies on the dollar, good business people know that it is not feasible to get a return on their investment given the kinds of work that has to be done to bring the property up to code and to make it livable or to be able to do business with it. You know, again, I think what business folks are looking for is certainty. I think having a plan that people know what we're looking for, what is our shared vision as a community is important. And I also think that, you know, when the city can demonstrate with partners in the private sector what is possible, it only builds the enthusiasm for more investment and it becomes an issue of critical mass. And I do believe that the tide has started to change. I think that Hagerstown is moving in the right direction. And I think, you know, the one of the fundamental issues always comes down to money. The city administrator creates the budget every year. And, you know, we, I think, try to make not only all the operations of the city government quality operations, but we also have to look at the available funds to be able to provide those incentives and grants to create that critical mass.
Mr. Geisberts, without mentioning your opponent, how do you plan to effectively lead Hagerstown?
Well, I'm going to do what I think we've been able to do for these past almost 4 years, which is leading in a way that engages stakeholders, to engage the community. I am a huge fan of the Baldrige excellence in business, government, education, whatever realm that you're talking about. But this philosophy that you know, we should be valuing and obtaining stakeholder feedback and using that to help guide our decisions, that we should be making data-driven decisions you know, with that stakeholder feedback, and we should be focusing on continuous improvement. So whether that's with infrastructure, with our environment, with customer service, I believe that, as I've said before, that we should be looking to turn liabilities into assets. We should also continue to strengthen our neighborhoods. I think that one of the things that's very critical is having strong and safe neighborhoods where families feel safe and want to continue to invest in their community. So again, I'm going to continue to lead with a positive vision, one that brings people together, one that makes people feel like they really do have a stake in what's happening and will be leading together. I have always said that I possess a gavel, not a magic wand. And you know, it's very flattering when people ask me what my vision is for the city of Hagerstown, but I really prefer to work with stakeholders to have that shared vision, because I know that that is how we will be able to achieve all of our goals, is with everybody working together.
Well, I believe that getting stakeholder feedback and having all those people involved is very important. I also believe that you must listen to those individuals that you get involved. You know, there are two ways to go about leadership. One is to be out in front of things on a constant basis, and maybe at times to be the person who gets the brunt of the discourse. And then there's the leadership where, you know, the city administrator puts together the budget. You know, we have no control over the budget. We have no control over this or that. It's not true. There are two signatures on the ordinance for the city of Hagerstown's budget. One is Donna Spickler, the city clerk, and the other is the mayor.
Those are the only two signatures. And to think that even though the mayor does not have a vote, the mayor does possess the opportunity to lead and to give direction and to offer things that can make a difference. You know, a 15.7% property tax increase. And there are people out there currently in city government who will say, well, things didn't get done during the tax savings administration of Bob Brucci. It's not true. Just not true. We just did it fiscally responsible. We hired 10 new firefighters, 5 new police officers. We built a new fire station. We helped build a new regional library. We maintained our city streets and, you know, and kept our public safe and did all that without a tax increase. I believe it can be done. And when I lead the city of Hagerstown forward, it'll be done in a common sense form that makes sense for everyone involved.
At this point, I'm going to hand it back to Jones.
So we're a few minutes ahead of schedule, and as a result, we're going to extend the answer period for the final question. It is more or less a closing remark of sorts, and we had 3 minutes slated, but we're going to extend that to 5 minutes for each candidate to be able to speak to the question. And the question is, why, simply said, why should we vote for you? So with that, it's your opportunity, 5 minutes, and we'll start with David Geisbertz.
Well, thank you again for the chamber, to the chamber for this opportunity. You know, I am a working professional. I've been a school counselor for 13 years. I love my job as a school counselor, and I'm not looking forward to giving that up. I got a long time till I can retire, and I get bored easily. So being the mayor is a lot of fun. It's a lot of challenge. But what I think, what I know is that there are many transferable skills that I have been able to bring to the table. One of which is the constant contact with everyday families, ordinary people, and what they're dealing with in their daily lives. I've always been motivated by serving others and not particularly motivated by serving special interests. So my goal is always to do what is right for the whole community. I believe I have the vision, the skills, and the character to be the best mayor and focusing on bringing people together, finding that common ground, and achieving that shared vision. I stated before, one of my abiding philosophies is to look to turn liabilities into assets. I think that maybe that's just my eternal optimism, but I'm always looking for the bright side and focusing on the positive. You know, I absolutely believe in mediation and resolving conflicts, but what I also know is that sometimes in order to resolve a conflict, you have to start one. And I think there are ways that you can do that that are that we can create change out of those conflicts and create a positive result. I think I've been able to demonstrate leadership in accomplishing difficult tasks, and I think that's one of those things I know from being a counselor and knowing how to listen to people and really hear what's happening in all different sectors of the community, and then once again coming up with that shared vision and a path forward that helps everybody. I've said it before, I believe in data-driven decision making. You know, when we make decisions about whether it's the budget or regulations or any other decisions that come to our table, I believe that we should be making data-driven decisions and focusing on continuous improvement. I really do believe that Hagerstown's best days are ahead of us. You know, I know a lot of folks in my parents' generation, Bob's generation, have a lot of fond memories of the way things were in Hagerstown. But once again, my optimism, my future-oriented thinking tends to lead me towards creating the better future that I know we're capable of having. So, you know, I really believe that we should be continuing to look forward and not look back. And I believe one of the biggest reasons people should vote for me is because I am a change agent. I believe that that's one of the things that that I can do to continue to help Hagerstown is to bring change in the way we do business, the change in our philosophy, our way of looking at ourselves, about creating a more positive environment for the city of Hagerstown to grow into the future.
Same question, Bob Ricci.
Listen, I don't use fancy words like data-driven information and a change agent and those kind of things. I don't do that. You know, I lead by example, which means that if there's a problem in an area someplace, I don't just send my inspectors or my water department or my sewer department or anything like that when I was the mayor. I went and I checked it out too, because I think it's important, even though, as Dave points out, you know, the mayor has little control over voting on certain issues, but the mayor has a lot of control over using his influence in the community and also with the council. You know, I've been around Hagerstown for 58 years. I know. And I've seen it in its heyday, and I watched it deteriorate, and then I watched good things start to happen again. Good things because of the initiatives that I helped champion, the University of Maryland in downtown, and the expansion over into the CVS building. The artist's loss and the art gallery of, you know, on Nobo Street, the outside dining on South Potomac Street. We've done some great things in Hagerstown, and it appears that every time we move forward, something happens and knocks us back. Back in 2008, 2009, we suffered the worst recession since the Great Depression, and the city of Hagerstown has still not come out of it. And because, unfortunately, municipalities are usually the last ones to do that. I can promise you that I, too, believe that our best days are still before us, but it's going to depend on who the captain is at the helm. We have the opportunity with working with our counterparts in government, Washington County, the state of Maryland, even the federal government, to make great things happen. We have to be able to have that person in City Hall who understands how to deal with those kind of elements and to bring those people together. We need to figure out in this city, how do we keep our citizens safe? What do we do about our heroin problem? What do we do about our quality of life crimes that we see that are happening out in the north end of town and other places where cars are getting broken into, stuff stolen out of yards, garages getting broken into? We have to figure that out. Now, I believe that this administration has done one thing correctly, and that is hire Chief Brito. And I feel that working with Chief Brito, we can find a way to address these issues and to make our citizens feel safe again, to allow them to not be afraid to go downtown at 9 o'clock at night or things like that. It's important. And whether it's real or perceived, it is at least looked at in this community that the city of Hagerstown is unsafe. So let's work together. Let's make the downtown and the rest of Hagerstown safe. And let's bring common sense government back to City Hall. Thank you.
With that, that closes our forum this morning. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the candidates for the mayor and the city of Hagerstown, and like to thank you both for being here this morning, for sharing your thoughts so passionately, and I'd like to also thank those in the audience for being here this morning, for coming out, and for helping to make an informed decision come November. Our next forum is, as Paul pointed out at the beginning this morning in the announcement section, is next Wednesday. It is a forum that covers the city council election.
Thursday.
That's what I said. Thursday the 13th will be our next one. And it will be, I believe, the city council. And so I got that part right. So we look forward to each of you being here again next week. And again, thanks to the candidates. Thanks to the chamber for hosting. And I hope you all have a great day.